Bombay Stock Exchange has been a co-partner to the Compliance 1010 celebrations for the last few years. In honor of this association, we welcome MD and CEO of Bombay Stock Exchange, Shri Ashish Chauhan, to the podium for his brief address. Mr. Chauhan is the MD and CEO of Bombay Stock Exchange, Asia's oldest exchange, the world's fastest exchange with 6 microseconds response time, the largest exchange with over 500 plus listed companies, and India's first universal exchange to offer trading across all asset classes. He is credited with reviving BSE and completing its IPO. He was also instrumental in setting up India's first international exchange called the India International Exchange in 2017. He has prior experience of working with Reliance Industries as the president and group CIO, the head of corporate communication, and as the CEO of Mumbai Indians in its formative years. He is considered to be the father of modern financial derivatives in India, one of the foremost experts in financial market policies, and has been recognized as the Digital Icon of the Year by Indian Express Group. He has also been ranked amongst the top CEOs in the financial markets by Asian Banker and amongst the top 50 CIOs in the world by Information Week US.
Shri Arun Kulkarni, Shri Suhas Tuljapurkar, friends, ladies and gentlemen, I am most grateful to Legasis for inviting me to talk to you today on the Compliance 10x10 event. It's a unique event organized on October 10 by Legasis for the last many years. I have spoken on many occasions in this event. It is even more of a pleasure for me to speak on the important topic of compliance and corporate governance, particularly on the ethical perspective. It's a fact that many of the most spectacular failures of corporate governance in recent years have been due to poor ethics. So a discussion of the principles of corporate governance can indeed yield lessons for all of us. Failure of corporate governance has been at the root of recent well-known cases of failures and management frauds on the shareholders. An example of bad governance and unethical practices. These failures disappoint shareholders, other stakeholders, governments, and everyone, and detract them from performance of other companies involved and weaken the economic system in general. We have seen recently similar situations in banking, in bond defaults, in mutual funds, NBFCs, and few other areas. And that is worrisome. Corporate governance, whenever it works, it reinforces ethical standards. And wherever it fails, it permits unethical practices. The boards have a great role to play in ensuring that transparent, fair, efficient, and ethical practices are followed by all managements in every listed company as well as unlisted company. The essence of modern capitalism, that is trust, is what the corporate governance brings to the fore. Absence of trust or absence of corporate governance affects not only the companies indulging in unethical practices, but the entire ecosystem. And every company has to suffer due to the fault of few. The World Bank's Ease of Doing Business 2020 report, India has moved 14 places to 63rd place amongst 190 nations in this ranking. The country was 77th among 190 countries in the previous ranking in 2019, which was an improvement of 23 places. But more importantly, for protection of minority investors, India is ranked 7th now. Earlier, it was ranked 10th in 2019, whereas in 2020, it has become 7th in protecting minority investors. So India is pretty much the Vishwa Guru, as I say, in corporate governance and protecting minority investors. And we should be justifiably proud of what SEBI has done and what the government actions have done, including the Ministry of Corporate Affairs and Stock Exchanges over the last almost 25, 26 years since India started following these practices. The establishment of a modern insolvency regime in 2016 and later on its implementation has actually paved the way for improving India's ranking in this kind of ease of doing business and minority protection ranking in the World Bank. The first ever norms for corporate governance in India were laid down by SEBI in the year 2000 through introduction of the landmark clause 49 in the listing agreement. It's not that the corporate governance norm was not practiced before, but it was not in a codified form. Of course, the reporting, quarterly reporting before that, annual reporting, and many other things that codified in the listing agreement, which exchanges used to sign with the listed companies. And there are incidents in 1920s and 1930s, even court cases related to corporate governance and unethical practices on Bombay Stock Exchange. So in effect, the Bombay Stock Exchange has always been at the forefront of corporate governance practices, setting them up as well as ensuring that all the corporates follow them. And that's why BSE has been responsible as a catalyst in creating the great wealth of more than $2 trillion, almost $2.3 trillion today. Since it started in 1875, with few companies today, with almost 5,000 companies and $2.2 trillion of wealth. Almost one-fourth of India's wealth is represented in listed capital by way of equities and debts on BSE. That is because that's where BSE helps Indian corporates create trust. As I said, the first corporate governance framework defined by SEBI in 2000 came out of Kumar Mangalam Birla Committee. And since then, various committees were constituted on the subject from time to time, which made appropriate recommendations and built upon what the Kumar Mangalam Birla Committee actually recommended. There was Naresh Chandra Committee, Narayan Murthy Committee, J.J. Irani Committee, and many, many other committees which did minor or major work since 2000. The regulations have accordingly undergone updations and revisions. I mean, each time a new committee is set up, people start thinking that there are going to be more regulations. So more recently, the Kotak Committee, where I was also a member, made wide-ranging recommendations on various aspects of corporate governance. Most of the committee recommendations were accepted by SEBI and then codified later on. Majority of these recommendations have been implemented with effect from April 1, 2019, and the remaining ones from April 1, 2020. Many of us think this is a practice in futility, but that's what has helped India create that trust in the minds of Indian investors, retail investors, institutional investors, as well as foreign investors, that Indian laws and practices in corporate governance for protection of minority investors is one of the best in the world. And that is what helps them invest or make them think that in India, investment in listed companies is a good idea. The SEBI has simplified recently the rights issue processes to make it more efficient and also effective by creating a framework of LODR. And LODR, again, is a new invention. It came up in 2015. That is basically earlier only the listing regulations or listing agreement. Given that the LODR has come in a way to override the listing agreement, which used to be actually an undertaking by the listed companies to the exchanges. Now there has been a much better regulatory framework that has come in called LODR. Now I would like to bring your attention to several regulations that are modern, forward-looking and unique to India in at least some ways. These issues relate to the board evaluation, which need to be done every year, rotation of auditors, which has to be done in a periodic basis, compulsory corporate social responsibility spend of 2% for most large companies, independent women directors on the board of companies, dividend policy declaration by top 500 companies, business responsibility report to be published by top 1,000 companies, majority of minority for all decision making, and in that context, the related party transactions and how they need to be handled. I think these are in some ways very unique to India, and they've helped India overcome some of the lacunas which other countries are currently facing in their regulatory framework and protection of minority rights. If you just look at the reporting on the women director, which has been done by companies, almost more than 3,000 companies have reported before December 31, 2019, their compliances. Out of total 20,000 firm meeting directors in those 3,000 companies, 3,734, almost 18.2% are women directors. And that compares favorably with the rest of the world. India is now ranked 12th in the world in terms of representation of women on its board of directors. So I think overall, Indian corporate sector should be justifiably proud of its achievements in being at the forefront of the corporate governance movement across the world. In terms of the way I look at the corporate governance and the ethical framework, there are largely two situations that happen. One is what I call the asymmetry of power, and the second is what I call asymmetry of information. The insiders usually have a large amount of power and large amount of information vis-a-vis the outsiders. And that's where basically the asymmetries occur. And the entire corporate governance, wherever in the world, they try to reduce that power which insiders have over outsiders. And the information, which is in some sense power only, but that can come into many benefits. And that's where basically the corporate governance, in my opinion, are sort of working on these two pillars of how do you reduce the asymmetry of power and asymmetry of information available in any corporate governance framework. And that's what we need to be basically working on. India has done wonderful work, especially at the regulatory and at the law level, in bringing down the asymmetry of power by doing this minority, majority of minority. Related party transaction and other things. And insider trading regulations, and along with the periodic as well as material disclosure framework, have ensured that India is pretty much at the top of the scale in this corporate governance framework as far as the information and power is concerned. Of course, there are many aspects of how to organize this information dissemination, information disclosure, and also ensuring that all the asymmetry of power related issues are taken care of. And that's where BSE has created a listing center where companies need to disclose their periodic information, their compliances, and so on and so forth. And that is available 24 hours a day without any holidays. So literally, 365 or 366 days, the companies are able to register their information on BSE's website. So, which goes directly to the public without anyone in BSE looking at it, literally in a few milliseconds of company reporting that information. And we have created this one-time password-based system, like what we do in credit card payments or debit card payments. Here also at BSE's listing center, we need to, whenever a company tries to register their information of disclosures or any other thing, they get an one-time password, the relevant people who have been registered beforehand with us. And then when they register with the exchange, it directly is disclosed to the public without any human intervention from the BSE side. Of course, that also puts an onus on the companies to ensure that they don't misuse this sort of prerogative of giving out the information. And so they have to be very careful that they don't misuse or misrepresent or don't load data which is not legible or the data which is wrong. And that's what we expect from the companies. Of course, not many companies are misused, and we are thankful to them for being disciplined, so that the responsibility of the company is to also ensure that the information, right information in right format, which is the public. We have also recently, with the help of SEBI's regulations, made XBRL, that is Extensible Business Reporting Language, compulsory for almost every disclosure, actually the financial disclosures. So that as and when the companies disclose their information in XBRL format that can go directly into the databases of analysts and general investors, so that the analytics can happen instantaneously and mistakes or any issues are identified immediately. So effectively, the Indian corporate governance framework is pretty much amongst the top in the world. As I said, we are ranked 7th for the minority protection in corporate governance as specified by World Bank in their rankings. And overall, the automation which we have been able to bring in at BSE has brought even further transparency and fairness to the entire framework of corporate governance. With that, I'm sure we'll have many more discussions taking place. And I wish this conference and this event a tremendous success. And in case any special suggestions that come out of this event, we will certainly discuss with the Legacies team and try to take up at BSE level, or if required, we represent to the regulator to take them up for ensuring that the investors get the best information, timely information, and also the rights on deciding on those information as they well deserve. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chauhan.